All right. Hello and welcome to KCP Community Meeting, November 9th, 2021. We have some discussion topics, but some PRs to go over and a doc that was shared. Clayton shared a terminology ADR. ADR is architecture design review document. Somebody can tell me if that's wrong. But basically, some terms that we usually throw around as if we know what they mean. This is a place to sort of argue about and agree on what those words mean. If you're curious, take a look. I think that will be useful. Andy also sent a PR recently to refactor how the KCP startup or server starts up. It seems in general good to me. I think Steve has also reviewed it. I don't know, Andy, if you have more you want to say about it.
I did just push up another fairly large commit to it. So what you've seen was about half of what's there now. And it elevates the creation of some clients and the shared informer factories higher up in the stack so that the clients and the informers can be shared by multiple controllers. And I also plumbed through the done channel from the context in as many places as I could find quickly this morning. So one positive effect there is that if you're just running the KCP process by hand and then you hit Control C to quit it, it takes much less time to shut down now because the I think it was the namespace controller was probably the thing that was keeping it open because it was basically coded to never stop. So that last commit is a bigger refactor, but it's really just moving stuff up. There's a chance that I got the order of something wrong because when you do it this way, you've got to make sure that the informers get started or get created, the factory gets created, then the controllers get created where they're referencing the informers, then you start the informers, wait for the cache sync, and then start the controllers. So I think I got the order right. The startup seems to look the same in terms of the log output, but definitely some eyes on that would probably be helpful just to make sure I didn't miss anything. And you know, if you all have tests that you run just to fiddle around with stuff locally, that would probably be good.
That's good to know. Thank you. As Steve said, the classic bait and switch, you get a couple of approvals and then you completely rewrite it from the ground up.
I'm also happy to split this third commit into a separate PR if you all want.
It seems fine to me. So we do have some tests. I don't see them running, which is weird. So I'll look into that. But we do have some end-to-end tests that run through the basic like demo scenarios. So that should at least prevent you from breaking, you know, everything.
Yeah.
Not to say there won't be subtle breakages that the demo doesn't cover, but great. I mean, any simplification is welcome because, as I'm sure you found out, this is very, very complex.
There's probably some more stuff that I will think about, but this was kind of phase one.
Nice. And last night I sent out a PR that is also pretty complex and pretty probably in need of some simplicity, which basically just reconciles namespaces. So we want to be able to schedule more fine-grained than just namespaces, but in the meantime, being able to schedule whole namespaces worth of things is better than what we do now, which is almost nothing. So this is an attempt to match up a namespace to a cluster, label that namespace for that cluster, and have it synced and scheduled there eventually someday. And any new resource that comes into a namespace, assign it to the same cluster as its namespace is assigned to. It also does some very basic health checking on a cluster. So if a cluster becomes unhealthy, it will shed all of the namespaces attached to it and have them reassigned somewhere else. I will not say that it is any kind of bulletproof, useful, good for production, anything, but it is, you know, miles ahead of what we have now. I need to write some tests for it. That's mainly why it's work in progress. I think just some basic tests to make sure that things work like we think they work would be useful. But aside from that, there is also a lot of syncer changes that will need to happen when this happens, because right now syncer will just take a namespace and put it into the cluster as the same namespace it was called in the logical cluster, and that's not going to work if we have two logical clusters that share the same namespace name. And there's also like filtering, like it shouldn't write kube system namespace stuff, and it shouldn't write anything, you know. There's a lot it shouldn't do that it currently would do if you tried to make it, so we should avoid that. But this is at least a step forward. I think I assigned it to Andy, but anyone is welcome to take a look at it and throw tomatoes or whatever. I admit it is not done, but it is at least better. Stefan has his hand up.
Yeah, I have a question about the general merge policy. Do I get that right? We basically do peer review, so people review, and preferably we don't self-merge, but somebody else, but we don't formalize that at the moment.
Right. I wouldn't say that we have a formal policy now. I think in general, we have not self-merged changes. If, you know, I would say depending on what the change is, if it's some typo change and it's approved, I don't have a problem with somebody self-merging. But if it's like Andy rewriting startup or me rewriting, you know, hundreds of thousands of lines of new controllers, I think somebody else should bonk the button for that. Yeah.
Our policy up to this point, I think, has been approve the PR, ignore it for like a month, and then...
very scalable and high velocity policy we have. Approve it, ignore it, approve it later, and merge it.
I like that. I mean, spreads the news that there's a PR. People who care, they jump onto it anyway. And when we feel there's consensus, somebody merges.
I think I hope nobody minded. I went through the PR queue and I saw a bunch of small stuff that had previously been approved. So I looked it through and pushed some buttons.
Yeah. I tend to not prefer policies until they are necessary, but if we are reaching the point where we think a documented, regimented, you know, actual automated process is useful, I think I would welcome it. But yeah. Does that sound
okay? We're not there yet. I agree.
I am open to entertaining the idea that we are there, if we think we are, but definitely the policy of approving and ignoring for a month is not something we should do. So maybe we should automate not ignoring things for a month. But yeah. Are there any other recent PRs or changes people want to talk about, or upcoming changes that people want to talk about? Take that as a no.
I think... I guess one of the conversations I was having with Andy is like, for the sharding work, I think it's possible to break it up into like discrete chunks that perhaps aren't very useful in and of themselves, but at least are like thematically similar. So there's no reason for the PR to be one monolith if we want to merge it. And we think that smaller PRs would help. I'm happy to do that.
Are you saying,
and I think also on the,
you have a large monolithic change you think could go in right now, but would are questioning whether you should break it up into smaller changes?
Yeah, so like the KCP sharding PR has like, I think it's a couple thousand lines now. I could try to break it up. My kubefork PR does have things broken out. I was also not entirely clear what we expected on the Kubernetes side. Like, there are definitely shortcuts I took. I'm not sure if we're trying to write commits that are like one for one going to be things we can take upstream.
I think if you can make them something that is easy to upstream, if it is trivial or relatively easy to do that, I think it would be nice. But I don't think I don't think we have to like spend a week crafting the absolute best upstream PR in order to get it merged into KCP or our fork. I think at least so far, what we have been doing in our fork of Kubernetes is whatever we have to. And then so far we've made like David made one good pass of like rebasing it on top of recent Kubernetes and cleaning it up a bit. I still don't think those changes are like exactly one for one ready to be upstreamed and everything, but yeah, I wouldn't worry too much about it. Don't make garbage, but don't try to make it pristine and perfect either, because no matter what, at the end of the day, you're going to have to, like, someone will make you make a change upstream also to be able to merge.
Yeah.
So.
But yeah, so I don't know, in that sense, like the KCP PR is large, but exists and is like fully functional. And then the one in the kube fork is at least more broken out into like individual changes. I had to do a lot of hackery in the end-to-end suite, but it's at least separate. And those are ready for review. Some of the changes there, like for instance, the manner in which I refactored client Go semantics to allow for clusterless clients scoping down to a cluster, like that only really makes sense once it's layered on top of some of the other changes. So it's currently in one place, but you know, we could, if we want to review pieces of it and merge it individually, that's fine too.
Yeah. Stefan, did you
have something? Yeah. I would like to see, not in this meeting, but in general, some discussion or some meeting where we go over the changes and identify those we want to push upstream, maybe early. I remember, Steve, you had the question about porting controllers upstream to be independent of resource version opaqueness or not non-compactness. This is something we have to start early, right? If we want to get that through. And should we track that and report here? I don't know, something not formal, but
I think there's are we also generating functional, non-behavior changing but cleanup changes that will lay the groundwork and help us, like small changes that will help us along our path, but are not necessarily needing of a KEP and not necessarily needing of a, you know, discussion about where we're going with all of these. I think small changes could be upstreamed relatively easily if we have them.
And there are great things you can just pick up. New people who want to contribute and help, they can just pick one of those things and try to get them upstream.
Yeah.
I remember it's a bigger topic, but I remember that it's like splitting up the aggregator upstream from the API extension API server. Now it's really bundled and it forces us to have API services in KCP. We don't want that. And this is something doable now, even when we are still very, very explorative with other topics.
Yeah, especially things that are just cleanups and sanity changes that don't change functionality or don't change, you know, behavior or anything. As we identify those, we should put them somewhere, maybe in an issue of things we want to upstream or a doc of things we want to upstream. There's no reason to hold off on those, right? If they're small, if they're not behavior changing, if they're just cleanups, especially cleanups that will help us later. Like you said, it takes a while anyway to get them upstream, so we should start as soon as possible. Steve, go ahead.
Sorry, I was going to say, let's create a doc and start to enumerate the, you know, full set of things that we've done, probably with the eye to what we'd like to do, you know, and then start creating those tasks that you were talking about, Stefan. And then maybe later this week or at the next community meeting, we can review them and start to you know, have a more concrete plan for going upstream to kube.
Sounds good.
Yeah, great. Anything more on the topic upstreaming PR size preference shard aware transparent list watch specifically? All right. I wanted to bring up a topic we had talked about in some meetings over the last week, which is virtualizing resources. I think we in general think this will help a lot with either exposing different views of the same object in storage, because we can have a virtualized layer that sort of transforms it on the way out to the client. Or I think one way it came up in discussion that was new to me, which was when forking a workspace, I think I had mainly thought that we would create a new logical cluster and copy all the objects from previous workspace into new workspace. And now, boom, you've forked. But I think it was Clayton that was saying was that was too, copying objects both takes too long and costs too much. So instead we should have some virtualized like resource pointer that says, okay, now I've created a fork and it is literally just pointing at the same objects. And as you change the fork, you overlay on top of those or something. I'm not quite sure I understand. If others understand the concept better.
I think there's downtime involved because it just takes long. And this was a point. It's not that we cannot move data, but it's something transactional. It's complex. Without transaction, you have all the problems of inconsistencies. That's why a view is instant.
Yeah. Andy, is that what you were?
So I don't know about forking workspaces specifically, but I know from talking to Clayton earlier this week, which I guess was yesterday, he feels very strongly that creating a new workspace is a zero cost or as close to a zero cost operation in terms of storage, at least. So if you're going to create a new workspace that is of a specific type where the implication is you get a whole bunch of APIs pre-installed in your brand new workspace, the implication there is that you can't create a whole bunch of CRDs in the brand new logical cluster because that is more expensive than just creating like a workspace CR somewhere to track the fact that that exists, and then the APIs come from somewhere else. So it's stuff to explore.
Yeah, I think the CRD, I think we talked about that before, something like a CRD we need, but it could be of course something like a, I don't know, workspace type, which is synced to a cluster and then shared by many workspaces. This would work.
Yeah. So there's probably at least a couple of different use cases. Like I want to, I have an existing workspace that's got a whole bunch of deployments and other things in it, and I want to fork it. I haven't talked to Clayton about it, but my gut feeling is like, that's a copy, like you're copying the data that's in there. The alternative would be you do a copy on write type of optimization so that you somehow don't have actual storage copies until there is a change. And I think that the workspace forking is probably a different use case than I'm creating a brand new workspace and I want it to have some APIs pre-configured and pre-installed.
Yeah. So is the idea, as you understand it, that so I create a new workspace of some type, which means I get these, to me, it looks like it comes pre-installed with these 100 CRDs or whatever. In reality, those are just virtualized and pointing to some CRD definition elsewhere, maybe in another workspace. But then when I can change those CRD definitions and on write, those become real or?
I mean, so the use case that I would think of for that is like there's some service operator that is giving you, I don't know, cert manager as a service. So like you don't have to worry about installing it and operating it. And so if that operator entity is creating CRDs that represent issuers and certificates and things, the schema, the actual CRDs are read only to you as a consumer who's got them bound into your workspace. Like that's my gut feeling. And so if you wanted to modify one of those CRDs, it would either be rejected or maybe you are sort of forking it at that point. But I don't know, I would tend to say, like, if it's operated by somebody else, you shouldn't be mucking with the schema. Go ahead, Stefan.
Yeah, that could be virtual. That's what Jason said. And just as a background, we have CIDs which are near to the limit of objects, like a megabyte of data. So 100 of them means 100 megabytes of JSON per workspace. And if you think one cluster of etcd today has 8 gigabyte max of memory, this limits the number of workspaces considerably. So it's real. The problem is real. It's not just optimization.
Yeah. Yeah. Virtualizing these things seems like, well, it seems important. It seems like we have to, but also seems like a fairly large unspecified area of work. Like, where, how is virtualization implemented? How does it look to users?
I think that I would caution us to be careful about using virtualization as an overly broad and generic term, because somebody's got to go write some code somewhere to do whatever task it is you're trying to do. So if you want to say there's a CRD in logical cluster A, and I want it to magically be available in logical clusters B, C, D to Z, like, there's specific code that has to be written to do that. There's different code that you have to write if you want to create a resource that represents the workspaces I have access to. So I think, at least for me personally, talking about just virtualization, I struggle with it because it's a very useful concept, but it has specific implementations for each thing you're trying to do. And so I would prefer to talk about, like, each specific use case.
And we have examples like projects in OpenShift. So we have experience with that. Publishing the same object in different places is pretty simple. It's pretty much a shortcut, an API endpoint, nothing else. If you project and you think about updates and writes and so on, this is getting complex. So the big topic of virtual workspaces with LCD, GCD, and maybe other things, this is a big thing. Making something visible, that's the easy part.
Yeah, and I think even, well, I guess to Andy's point, we shouldn't over-design it in general, because it will mean different things on different for different things. Like, do people even understand where in the layers of the code that would even happen? Like, where would we put something that takes a request to list CRDs and is able to forward those on? That's, do we have ideas where that goes?
API extension. API server has a place, basically a handler, HTTP handler. It checks the HTTP path for APIs it knows, and then calls the right handler. It's that's pretty simple. That's what I said. Making things visible in the API surface, this is the easy part. We can prototype that if somebody wants to play with that. Shouldn't be too hard.
Yeah, that was something that David and I were starting to talk about yesterday. And I think he was going to take a look at it, but he's going to be out for a little bit. So I may pick that up in his absence. And Jason, to your question, I think there's probably a difference between hacking with some of the existing infra, like CRDs, versus I just want to create a new resource type and back it with custom code. Like, that's typically what you'd do with an aggregated API server in, like, standard Kubernetes. I think in KCP, that's where, like, I don't know where in the code we do that other than it's in the server somewhere. And so maybe we can work with Stefan or somebody else to just give an example. Like, here's where you would inject some code for a virtual resource.
Yeah. Do we, aside from virtualizing CRDs, is there another place we've talked about virtualizing? Or, like, to Andy, you said if we're copying a deployment, that's just going to be a copy. That's probably not going to need to be virtualized. Is there anything else we're talking about virtualizing or just?
Like workspaces, like as a relatively unprivileged client, I want to do list workspaces and have it return all the workspaces that I'm able to access. And that is a virtualized or materialized view on the full set of workspaces scoped down based on permissions.
Okay.
And I think Clayton has extended that to scope things similarly that are potentially cross workspace, but you need to limit to what you have permission to. So like going back with my cert manager example, I don't know that a client would necessarily want to do this, but you know, if you're a person and you say like, show me all my certificates across all my workspaces, that is another example where you need to only see the ones in the workspaces that you can access. And so like that, that probably falls under Steve's cross shard list and watch to a large extent, but I don't know how much is filtered by, you know, RBAC in there yet, if anything. Nothing. Yeah. I mean, given that we don't have the workspace as a type and we don't have workspace RBAC, I think that'll probably be the thing that comes after Steve's prototyping on cross shard list watch is, okay, now let's add the workspace types that David has in an open PR. Let's add RBAC. Let's add those virtual views on workspaces you can access and things in workspaces that you can access.
I have a question about David's PR, the API PR. This is not merged, right? And there were questions I saw.
I don't think it's merged yet. And I think we're at a, like, we can go ahead and just merge when it looks good. And if, you know, if it's good enough and we want to follow up real quick with some minor changes, we can do that. But having the types exist in the tree is better than having the PR stay open forever.
Yeah. I remember there was a question about spec and chart, right? That was the last one I remember.
My biggest question was like the entire layout of the thing. Like, I don't really understand why it Clayton necessarily like wrote it the way he did in the proposal.
Okay. But I would like to see that merged sooner than later.
Yeah, I mean,
David's out. We can either merge it now and then just change it afterwards or just open a separate PR. I mean, running the generators is not that hard. Do we want to have a conversation today about the actual shape of that? Like binding the workspace to a shard or scheduling it rather?
Absolutely. Sure. Yeah. I mean, what is the,
I think it's just
not to design or not to structure it this way.
Well, right now it's got a current shard and future requested shard field both in spec, and I don't fully understand why. Like,
yeah. I
kind of would just expect
the current is just misplaced, right? Target, of course, but not the one at the moment because you cannot change it.
Right. Yeah. So I would have just expected scheduled shard in the spec, and then status would show me like what the phase is and then what the conditions are.
If that's that seems reasonable and pretty small to do as a follow up after merging this, right? If we
agree,
those are like the only fields that exist on the CRD right now.
That's fine. Like,
I mostly just wanted to know why, because Clayton like specifically laid it out that way in the design doc, and I wasn't able to get.
So the thing that comes to mind for me is if we're in a recovery scenario and we need to recreate a workspace CR from a backup, you can't create with the status pre-filled. So if like you would need to be able to determine where it currently is and where it's in flight for moving and.
Yeah, there's an analog in POTS, right? Node name is a similar kind of. It's also something you could say the scheduler just fills in the status.
On recovery?
Well, no. I mean, it could, but like anytime you have to recreate something from scratch, then if something made a determination for replacement or, you know, for some sort of calculated value and it's not recoverable based on what you can observe. So, you know, the scheduler has made a decision. I'm going to put this pod on some node. If that goes into status and then, you know, for whatever reason you have to recreate the pod, then there's no way to, unless you can go somehow query the system and say, okay, this pod's been recreated. Can the system kind of tell me where it was?
But isn't this placed? Is this similar? I mean, a pod becomes an identity in the moment it's scheduled, and then it's owned by this kubelet. It cannot be moved again. It's like in this scheduled state, end state, final state, terminal state. Same thing for workspace. It doesn't make sense to reschedule the workspace elsewhere, because also etcd data belonging to it.
Well,
node, right?
There's a move that we are planning on implementing.
Yeah, but the move just needs a status field. But in your use case of reconstructing, does this even make sense? Reconstructing,
right? So we'd have to be in the middle of a move where status has been updated, or sorry, spec has been updated to the new place, but it hasn't quite caught up yet. And we would have to crash in the middle of that move and then need to recover there.
Yeah, I think if you're in the middle of a move and you like lose etcd and you're recovering from a backup, like that's a very complicated edge case to work through. I think in the interest of making progress on stuff, we just merge the PR as it stands. And if we want to adjust fields today or in a month or whatever, we can do it.
Okay. Yeah, I was thinking it might make sense just to talk it through once, because that would be like the use case of reading and writing this object right now.
Yeah, I mean, setting a target is only for moving, I would think.
You would never create it with a target in.
I think you'd have to, right? Like when you create it, you have to set the target, and then something would have to update spec when it's done. And then it also changes the semantics of how you read the status, right? Because right now in status, you record current and like first and last resource version, like the resource version boundaries that I was present on the specific shard, right?
Which is also important for moving. So it's like current. It's not much
different. And then like, I don't know, having current and future in spec, but then also having like a migration phase and resource version boundaries in status, like it just sort of bifurcates the data there. Right?
There's another possibility, which we may not decide to pursue for a variety of reasons, but if you wanted to do a move, you could hypothetically set a paused field on the workspace spec so that it rejects any new writes.
Then we have to.
Yeah, then you create a new CRD, which is like a workspace move CR. And that can contain the information that says, this workspace needs to move from here to there. Here's the resource versions that I need to capture. And then you can have a controller operate on that and go and update the actual workspace when the move is done.
There's also something, Andy, and you discussed this with Clayton, I think. Having another index for the shard mapping workspaces to shards, not to fill everything into the workspace, but to have something different, smaller, more efficient,
Yeah.
Available everywhere, maybe.
Yeah, and I was chatting very, very briefly with Clayton yesterday that I think we're probably at a point where somebody or somebodies need to start actually designing what does it look like for a client to make a request to a workspace when there's a shard index. So like design the index, figure out the scaling on that. Will it fit into memory? If it won't fit into memory, do we need multiple layers and multiple proxies? Well,
right. And so this was something I was thinking about previously, but I think like maybe we can take this offline. But I think, you know, since the workspace object right now, the entire point of it is to store this like shard mapping, and everything that we choose to do with that object depend like that informs how we create the index, how we like what's the access pattern for this data. We should probably nail this down before we like it makes sense to think
this yeah I mean what I've seen in various docs to date is that there will be a potentially a series of KCP instances that hold organizational workspaces. So it's like a workspace where the type is organization.
Administration is a better word. Organization is a company, isn't it?
Yeah.
Confusing.
But that those would have workspace CRs in them for the actual workspaces. And so I don't know what the top level index would be, but assuming you can figure out what organization you're in, you go find the shard that has that org, and then you can go look at the workspace CR on there to figure out what shard the workspace is on. But again, like we need to actually design all of this.
It feels like we can postpone merging this and getting a design for the whole big thing. I don't think it makes sense. I mean, this will come at some point, and Steve has to adapt his PR as a proxy. The proxy has to learn the new concept at some point. But to start with some mapping, we can merge and just use it.
Yeah, well, like one thing that Clayton was interested in having David explore after the workspace types get merged is adding just a placeholder field on the workspace spec to say, my type is some string, and then the value is the name of another workspace. And so then basically like you'd have the code that would say, okay, you know, here's this new workspace. It points to some other workspace. Let's go find all the CRDs in that reference workspace and then go make them virtually available to this workspace. And so like that's an avenue of exploration that we could do.
This sounds like project requests where you have a list of objects, and if you virtualize all of them, it's basically a no-op operation, just virtual mapping resources. You can have 100 of them in some workspace type or in some blueprint workspace, and it's instant because they're virtual. You have everything instantly in the new one. On write, you fork, of course, but not before.
Yeah, so we need to, you know, prototype that too. All right, what's this, Steve? You want to understand why the original doc has current feature split and spec? Yeah,
yes,
let's follow up with Clayton.
Yep. Let's try to do that today. And then if it's not clear, we can just make a version 2 of the PR if David's up for a while.
Sounds good.
So we think the consensus is that we are not merging the PR until we understand it. And if our understanding evolves such that we should not just merge it in the state that it's in, we'll make a V2 that does it the way we think it should be. Is that right?
Yeah, I think we should try and get Clayton's time today. And basically, we don't need to merge it until somebody needs to do something with a workspace CR, which could be CRD prototype
3 weeks ago when I was trying to build the index. It could also be 3 weeks ago when I was thinking about the indices. So yeah, I mean, I think like getting it in soon is good.
If it's all of days and not all of weeks, I think it's fine.
Yeah, let's assume it's going in today or tomorrow.
Or that we're going to make a V2 that goes in today or tomorrow. Okay. Great. Does anyone have anything else to talk about on that topic or other topics? All right. In that case, I feel sort of inclined to end early, unless people feel differently. All right. See everybody later.
See you. Thank you.